know, of all the amazing things about the universe, I think two stand above all the rest. One of them is that we know so much about the universe. But another is that there's even more that we don't know. And what I want to focus on for this lecture is the inexplicable universe from a time gone by that is now explained. Human cultures have for a long time harbored scientific mysteries. In fact, in the pre-scientific era, that would be before Galileo, 400 years ago, before then, many of nature's most unknown mysteries were thought to be the work of divinity. Take, for example, epilepsy. There's someone writhing on the ground, your best friend, frothing at the mouth. If you're driven by Christian theology, your first thought is the person is possessed by the devil. That's the natural explanation for what's going on there, in the absence of any other knowledge about neurosynaptic processes. In another example, you could go out to the woods one morning, one damp, cool morning, and you'll find this circle of mushrooms. No one knew how they got there. You were there the day before, there was no trace of mushrooms. And now, there's a perfect circle of them. These were known as fairy circles. And people imagined sort of woodland nymphs, woodland fairies, coming to have a jamboree, and these were their chairs. Little fairies, of course. These were their chairs, where they celebrated, whatever were their rituals of the night. We would later learn that, of course, mushrooms they're not solo organic entities. They're, in fact, one spore can generate many, many mushrooms. And if a spore drops in one spot, it can work its way out and get ready for just when the conditions are right, just the right temperature, just the right humidity. And then they all pop up, equidistant from where that spore first dropped. So explanations came later to these phenomena. And of course, we know epilepsy is the result of random firing of the brain, uncontrolled firing, that leaves you helpless in the presence of a brain gone awry. So what we found is that things started to change in the rise of the experiment. If you go back in time to Aristotle's day, people imagined that you could just sit in a chair and just think about the universe. You didn't have to go out and test it. You just thought it up. Aristotle imagined that heavy things fell faster than light things. Of course, yes, a rock falls faster than a feather. The feather feels the air resistance on its way down. But take a heavy rock and a light rock, they'll actually fall together at the same rate. Aristotle, however, said that the heavy one will fall faster than the light one in direct proportion to its weight. This is patently false. And it would take Galileo 1,500 years later to demonstrate that this was the case. He describes the experiment of dropping two balls from the side of the Leaning Tower of Pisa. And they're both falling at exactly the same rate, hitting the ground at the same time. Of course, that would happen with a rock and a feather. You just have to evacuate the air from where you're doing the experiment. And in fact, that was indeed done, that very experiment, on the surface of the moon. So what I want to do for this lecture is focus on several stunning examples of profound mysteries that plagued the deepest thinkers of their day, but ultimately got explained.